like to introduce our banquet speaker this evening. He is, of course, Professor Philip Rushton, the author of Race, Evolution, and Behavior. It introduces a revolutionary theory about the origins of racial differences. When Professor Rushton first publicized its conclusions in 1989, this is the sort of thing that was explained to you by Dr. Francis earlier today, but the premier of the province of Ontario called for his dismissal. The Ontario Attorney General's Office began an investigation to determine whether or not he had, in the words of the bureaucrats, poisoned the learning environment. It is, I must say, a rare book that is reviewed on the cover of American Renaissance. We review quite a few in the inside pages, but Professor Rushton's book is the only book that we saw of sufficient importance to review right on the cover. And I'm glad to say that even the New York Times and National Review had sense enough to give the book at least respectable reviews. This, of course, did not stop the Canadian Customs from impounding a shipment of these books into Canada, and it took them 9 months of close scrutiny to determine that this wasn't hate literature after all. Now, in fact, it makes you awfully grateful to have a First Amendment when you watch the antics of countries that don't happen to have one. Among his many honors, Professor Rushton is a fellow of the Guggenheim Institute. He's the author of more than 160 scholarly papers and 6 books. He is currently professor of psychology at the University of Western Ontario, and it is a great honor and a pleasure to introduce to you Philip Rushton, who will speak to you this evening on the American Dilemma in World Perspective.
Thank you very much. Well, it's a very great pleasure to be here, and thank you for that opening round. I wanted to start off with some editorial cartoons. As Sam Francis was saying, there was a lot of discussion of my views when they first became public in Canada about 6 years ago, and this is just the first of many editorial cartoons. I'm going to show you 4 or 5 just to give you a flavor of it. This is my favorite, actually. maybe you could go to the second one. The general theme was the question of academic freedom versus racism, and here you have the venerable academic freedom holding aloft the likes of Darwin, Freud, and Galileo, while I'm trailing along, hiding behind the cloak, holding a book, Racial Studies and Superiority, I think it's called that. Okay, we can go to the next one. Oh, as you'll be finding out, a lot of the studies that I've done are about brain size and IQ, and a favorite theme was the question of whether brain size actually did correlate with IQ, so this is me measuring my own head, and obviously I have a pinhead because I came up with such foolish theories. Go to the next one. One of my debating partners was Professor David Suzuki, who's a well-known Canadian scientist and left-wing agitator, I guess I could say. And here he is holding a tape measure and saying, yes, Professor Rushton has a point. Some whites do have thicker skulls. So they like that one. Now, here I am in a Ku Klux Klan, but I'm measuring my head rather stupidly. And in fact, I sued over this particular cartoon. We sued the newspaper, took out libel action against them. And it did bring the newspaper campaign to a complete and absolute halt. So that was... So I think now I'll turn a little bit more seriously to measuring the brain. And I'm going to tell you, if you can go to the next slide, that there are, in fact, four different ways of scientifically measuring the size of a person's... Oh, I guess I forgot one. When the bell curve came out about a year ago, I was interviewed, what did I think about the bell curve? And of course I said it was a great book. So here I am holding up the bell curve with my thin head just poking out. Okay, now we'll go to the, I think. Okay. Well, here we have the real brains. And I was going to say there are four different ways of measuring brain size. The scientists, even today in the 1990s, use, and I'll be telling you a couple of the findings about modern research. The first way is to take a wet brain out of the skull at autopsy and put it into a pan and weigh it, and the average brain weighs about 3.5 pounds, but as we shall see, there's a lot of variation around that average. The second way of doing it is to find a skull somewhere in the earth and dig it up, fill up the holes, and then fill the skull with some kind of container, some kind of water or lead shot or bird seed. A variety of things can be put into the skull. These bird seed is then poured out of the skull into a graduated container, and you can measure how many cubic centimeters there are. And the average brain size or endocranial volume is about 1400 or 1500 cubic centimeters, which is roughly translatable into the same 3.5 pounds from the wet brain at autopsy. So this is the second way in which brains are estimated. We can go to the third way. You can estimate cranial size from external head measurements. That's what they were doing in those editorial cartoons, where they would put a tape measure around somebody's head. This would be one crude way of estimating the size of a person's brain. If you take the three measures that I've put on the slide, which is length, width, and height, and then multiply those three measures together, if you multiply those three measures together, you can get a cranial volume estimate from them. And again, you come out with the same kind of estimate of about 1400 or 1500 cubic centimeters. Now, a lot of different organizations take these kinds of head measurements. For example, the United States Army does it every 4 or 5 years. They take these measurements and every other body size measurement they possibly can, because what they want to do is to fit their recruits with helmets, with uniforms, with workstations, and so on. So they need very precise bodily measurements of all the people that go into the United States Armed Forces. You can access these, as I have done. You can then multiply these measurements together, as I have done. And you can calculate the brain size of, say, black people and white people, officers and enlisted personnel, and come up with estimates of brain size. You can go to the fourth way. And this is the most recent method, the highest tech method, magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI. Here you can actually put somebody into the MRI machine and you get in vivo a three-dimensional measurement of the brain, the brain's volume, which you can then relate, for example, to IQ test scores to test the hypothesis that brain size is related to IQ. And now there is absolutely no doubt at all in the scientific community, among those people who know, there are about 13 or 14 studies that have used magnetic resonance imaging to actually measure somebody's brain at the same time that IQ test scores have been taken. And the correlation between brain size and IQ is about 0.44. And for those of you who want to get a feeling for what the magnitude of that correlation is, it's about the same relationship that sociologists have found over and over again between social class of origin and brain size, or and IQ. So it's as big as is that correlation. Where am I? Okay, next slide. This is the only hard data in terms of numbers that I'm going to show you. I want to give you the idea that there is a real technical literature out here and report some of the racial differences in brain size. The first study uses brain weight at autopsy. This is a 1980 study. You don't have to go back to the 30s or the 40s of the 19th century. These are very modern studies published, all of them that I've been talking about, since 1980 in highly prestigious science journals. The first study was by Kenneth Poe and his medical colleagues at Wisconsin, the medical school at Wisconsin. And they published this in a journal called the Archives of Pathology. Because if you are taken to a hospital for an autopsy, one of the standard measurements is to take your brain out and to weigh it. Because whether the brain weight has expanded or contracted is one indicator for pathologists as to the cause of death. So what pathologists need are up-to-date norms on what is an average-sized brain, so that people can then find out whether the brain that they're looking at, the pathologist is looking at, is abnormal in some way. And so the standardized norms that were published in 1980 show Europeans, European Americans, with 1,323 grams and black Americans with 1,223 grams. In other words, a 100 gram difference between blacks and whites. 100 grams is about 1/4 pound, which is like 1/4 pound of hamburger. That's how much difference there is between black people and white people when all the corrections possible are made for body size. And since IQ correlates with brain size, this implies that blacks would not be as intelligent as whites on average. I'm going to go through the rest of the columns. The second row there, endocranial volume, is from skulls. And this is a worldwide sampling, and this introduces my theme that the black-white differences that we see in the United States and the dilemma that public policy people such as yourselves are addressing is in fact to be looked at in a world perspective, because the black-white problem in America is the black-white problem everywhere in the world. These particular skulls are taken from Africa compared to skulls found in Europe, compared to skulls found in East Asia, like China. And what you find here is surprise, and it was a surprise to many people, that Asians seem to have a larger cranial volume than do Europeans, just as Europeans have a larger cranial volume than do Africans. And this particular study, which reviewed up to 20,000 skulls from the entire world literature, was published by Kenneth Beals, who's a physical anthropologist at Oregon State University, in a mainstream anthropology journal, Current Anthropology. So this is absolutely mainstream science that most anthropologists know about. The third row there and the fourth row there are my own studies that I published in the last 3 or 4 years using those head size data that I put up in a slide, length, width, and height of the external head. And again, you see the first row of my studies is from the United States Army. And I had a stratified random sample of 6,000 people from the United States Army. And Asians have larger heads and, by inference, larger brains than do whites. Whites have larger heads than do Africans. I should point out here, as most of us know, that there is overlap. When we're talking about black-white differences, we're talking about average differences. And those average differences are really substantial. But that's not to say that there aren't many black people who score higher than the average white person. In the United States Army, for example, we find that the black officers actually have larger cranial capacities and higher IQ scores than do white enlisted personnel. But that's not to deny the average differences that exist, but it is important to be aware that there are exceptions to every rule, and this is an important one to note. Okay, we can go to the next slide. There's a question. Save those kind of questions for the end, if you don't mind, that's fine. There's a lot of variation from study to study, but each study shows consistently that blacks are smaller than whites, and whites are smaller than Asians, but there is variation across the studies. Now we come to the bell curve. This was a blockbuster event which transformed the scientific world. At the very least, the one thing it did for me in Canada was to make me suddenly respectable. Because Canadians are sometimes rather nationalistic and they want to bash Americans, it doesn't really matter what the issue is, and show that they're somehow different. There were a few mutterings when the bell curve came out and took a lot of attention. There were some mutterings in the Canadian media saying, well, you know, we had a Canadian who was saying all these things. So that was, I was pleased about the anti-Americanism for that one. But it has served to make a lot of the people like me who've been working away in this field and running into flack, and other people who are less public, but who ran into smaller amounts of flack, suddenly much more respectable than we had been before. And if not entirely respectable, at least they could no longer paint us as individual mavericks, individual cranks off in left field somewhere doing something outside of the mainstream. What the bell curve did was to, if not make us all mainstream, at least to show that we had a substantial subsidiary. There wasn't just one or two people, there were dozens of people. And I'll talk about the two or three aspects of the bell curve. First of all, everybody's discussed the bell curve, but I think it's important to know what the bell curve's scientific contribution was, which actually seems to have been lost in most of the discussion. What the bell curve did was to take about 13,000 adolescents at age 17, give them all an IQ test, and then follow them up to when they were 30 years of age and see what had happened to them, whether they had got good jobs, whether they were on welfare, whether they'd had illegitimate children, whether they were gone to jail, and so on. And what it showed was that the IQ score given to those children at age 17 was the single best predictor of where those people ended up in life at age 30. So it was better to be a black person with an IQ of 120 coming out of a ghetto with disrupted family members and so on. It was better from a point of view of ending up in a high position in life than to be a white person with an IQ of 80 coming from a parentally intact family, from a middle-class suburban family. IQ was the single best predictor for black people as well as for white people. But having said that, of course, it also showed that the bell curves for blacks was offset much lower than the bell curve for white, and that's what took most of the attention. The other thing that the bell curve took a lot of attention for which people like me are very grateful, is that it was a thoroughly footnoted book. Over and above describing its own scientific findings, it had a huge literature review and discussion of the work of a lot of other people, including my own work. And perhaps the most important person's work from the point of view of getting it all out was a major review by Richard Lynn that was published in the Mankind Quarterly in 1991, where he reviewed IQ data from around the world. Now, most of us know that blacks don't just exist in the United States. The majority of black people live outside of the United States. They live in the Caribbean. And of course, they live in Africa. And there are small parts of Africans who live in Britain and Canada and other countries as well. And what Richard Lynn did was ask the question, well, what is the IQ of blacks elsewhere in the world? And he reviewed all the studies that had been done of black people in the world. And one of the things he found was that black Americans are probably the most intelligent blacks in the world, which came as a great surprise to a lot of people, and this became very widely publicized. The other aspect of the bell curve that I will quickly mention is that, which I've already mentioned in a way, is that IQ is suddenly not just a good predictor of educational success or how far you go in your occupation, but it also is a good predictor of things like crime. Are you going to go to jail or not? If you go to jails and you take the IQ of people in jails, it's much lower than the average population. The average criminal in jail has an IQ of about 85. and that includes white criminals as well. Whether you have a lot of accidents in your life, traffic accidents, accidents at work, accidents in the home, is predictable by your IQ score. Whether you have disrupted families over and over again, and illegitimate children and so on, is itself predictable to some degree from an IQ score. So what the bell curve did was to put onto the table not just educational success, but all these other social variables on which whites score consistently higher than blacks. And the bell curve's argument was that the black-white differences you see in crime, in out-of-wedlock birthing, in welfare, and so on, is predictable from the black-white difference in IQ. Maybe we can talk about some of these other variables now, and we'll put another slide up if we can. We're going to talk about crime. This is a graph, essentially, put out by Glade Whitney in his presidential address to the Behavior Genetics Association last year. And what it shows is all the cities of the United States, what percent are they black? Well, the percentage black predicts how many crimes there are in the United States. The greater the proportion of blacks in the city, the more homicides there are in that city. The outlier way up there in the top right-hand corner is Washington, D.C., which is about 90% black and a very high murder rate. If we go to the next slide, you don't have, that's the wrong one. You should take that off. Is there a number 14 there? It is indeed. You don't have to look at those numbers. I'll explain them in a minute. I want to talk about crime in an international context. We know that blacks everywhere in the world have a lower IQ than do whites everywhere in the world. What has perhaps come as a surprise is that the black social behavior that you see in the United States is also to be found everywhere else in the world. Interpol is the international police organization. They publish a yearbook every year of crimes committed in other countries that subscribe to Interpol, about 100 countries in the world. And they just publish these figures as provided by the country. So you can go through the Interpol yearbooks, which are published in France, and look at the crime rates in Japan and China and Thailand and Africa and the Caribbean and Europe and so on. And so what I have been doing over the last 10 years is every 3 or 4 years I'll take the Interpol yearbook and I will collate across what I call rates. So I'll take all the African and Caribbean countries and call those the black countries, and take all the European countries as the white countries, and all the Pacific Rim countries and call those Asian countries. And what you find is that black African countries have 3 times the rate of murder, rape, and violent assault, serious assault, as do European countries. European countries have double the rate as do Asian countries. I didn't mention so far, but maybe I should, that people don't realize that Asians in America don't behave like whites. They actually score slightly higher than whites on IQ tests, about 4 or 5 IQ points higher than whites if you give IQ tests to Asians in schools or universities. This is also true, Richard Lin found, if you give these IQ tests to Asians in Asia. So if you re-standardize an American IQ test in Japan or the People's Republic of China or Singapore, you typically find that they score anywhere from 1 to maybe 11 IQ points higher than do white Americans or white Europeans. One of the implications of that, which Richard Lin went to town with, was to show that this means, one of the implications is that this means that the tests are not biased. The argument that blacks do poorly on IQ tests because white people constructed those tests and they're biased against black people, does not explain why Asians score higher than white on the white-created IQ tests. And they do so in Asia as well as in the United States. The pattern of Asians, whites, blacks is to be found worldwide on many, many different variables, including crime. In the United States, Asians commit fewer crimes of violence than do white people, and they have done ever since record keeping began. I'm talking about violent crime. In the 1920s, criminologists came across a problem. They wanted to explain why it was that in Los Angeles, the Chinese committed fewer acts of violent crime than did whites. And their answer back in the 1920s was the ghetto. They actually said that the ghetto protected the people inside the ghetto from the disruptive influences of the outside environment, which is paradoxical given that when the blacks get in the ghetto, the ghetto is said to cause the black crime rates. Asians have consistently shown lower rates of crime right up to today. And if you go to China and Japan and Singapore, they have, and these Interpol figures show it, they have lower rates of crime than do European countries. That is Poland and Germany and England and Wales and Scotland and so on. So the racial differences are universal. They're worldwide. What that means is you cannot explain why Asians have less crime and blacks more crime in Los Angeles by invoking anything that is particular to Los Angeles, or indeed anything which is particular to the United States. Because the phenomena is not unique to the United States, it is universal. So you need a more universal explanation if you're going to come up with a scientific understanding of what's going on. Okay, we can go to the next slide. Sexual behavior differences. Umpteen surveys have been carried out in the United States and around the world, especially by the World Health Organization. These particular measures here are age of first intercourse, percentage of virgins in the sample, and number of sexual partners reported in the previous 3 months. And what you find is that Asians basically are the most sexually restrained in these surveys. Whites are intermediate, and blacks are the least sexually restrained. They have an earlier onset of sexual activity, they have more sexual partners, and there are fewer percentage of virgins in any particular population. The World Health Organization have been carrying out these surveys around the world, especially in the wake of the AIDS crisis. So surveys are being done in high schools all across Black Africa, all across Europe, and throughout Japan and Asia. The pattern that you find in the United States is similarly to be found around the world. So in sexual behavior, you find exactly the same pattern of white consistently being intermediate to blacks and Asians in sexual behavior. And what this is very interesting, because what it implies is that there may be a sex hormone, some kind of neurohormonal transmitter which is mediating sexual behavior and acts of violence simultaneously. And testosterone is a very well-known sex hormone which differentiates mostly men from women. But we now know that Asians have less testosterone than whites, and whites have less testosterone than Africans. And this explains a variety of phenomena, not just sexual behavior, not just crime and violence, but all kinds of things like voice. Africans have a deeper voice than do whites. Whites have a deeper voice than do Asians. The depth of voice is mediated, is caused by the amount of testosterone circulating in the body. Muscular definition. Blacks get more muscle definition if they press weights and so on than do whites. It's very difficult for Asians to get much definition in the muscles as a result of weightlifting. And definition in muscles is due to testosterone. So this looks like a very real mediator of a lot of the social behavior variables, and it would explain a number of phenomena. If we can go to the next slide. Again, I shouldn't really be even putting this up. What it is a listing of countries all around the world, and essentially the number of AIDS cases per 100,000 population as a result of in that country. And what you find is, well, actually, let me jump from that to the most recent figures, which I haven't even made a slide of. They're so recent. The World Health Organization and the Centers for Disease Control in the United States, every 6 months, or in the United States every 3 months, publish the latest data on AIDS. And now today they're publishing them on HIV rates. Here's the bottom line. 2% of black Americans today, 2 out of every 100 black people, are living with HIV in the United States. In the Caribbean, there are 7 countries that now have 2% of their population living with HIV. In Black Africa, there are 37 countries whose population has 2% or more living with HIV. 5 of those countries have a 20% of their population, sexually active population, are living with HIV and will go on to get full-blown AIDS very soon. That's Uganda, Botswana, Zaire, Zimbabwe, I forget the fifth. It could be a number of them. The Republic of South Africa, those 5 countries have more than 20% of their population HIV positive. The Republic of South Africa has 3% of its black population infected with the HIV virus. Among whites in the United States or Europe, it's about 1 out of every 1,000, and among Asians in the United States, it virtually does not exist. So the sexual behavior differences that we saw translate into very real consequences. AIDS is mainly a sexually transmitted disease, and the racial differences are not just there in total amount, they're there in the pattern of AIDS. For example, among whites, it is almost entirely a homosexual problem. 95% of white people with AIDS are homosexuals. Among blacks, the sex ratio is about 60% male, about 40% female. And outside of the United States, in the Caribbean and Africa, it's a 50% male, 50% female situation, clearly showing that it's heterosexually transmitted. Now, consequences of this, and this, by the way, came out in the very end of January from the World Health Organization, maybe last November from the Centers for Disease Control. These figures are absolutely stunning. I've been following the AIDS figures for the last 10 years, and every now and again we'll collate them and publish them in some form. This was the last collation I did about a year and a half ago. I was stunned when I saw the HIV figures. This is a quantum leap in what anybody expected to be the case, and there's been almost nothing in the newspapers. The New York Times ran a big story where they focused in on Uganda, as though the 20% figure was unique to Uganda, omitting entirely the fact that all black African countries have very, very high rates, and this is impossible to check. There's not going to be any cure for AIDS in the next 4 or 5 years. If it's 2% of the population today, it'll be 3%. This is going to compound monthly. This is increasing exponentially. My prediction will be, and of course I could be wrong, is that if any one topic, and I've been debating this for the last 10 years, what will be the topic that breaks the race issue out into public awareness? Will it be crime? Will it be welfare reform? When the bell curve came out, I thought, well, it's going to be intelligence after all, because that's what we know most about. Now I'm leaning very, very strongly, to make a strong prediction, that it will be AIDS. In 4 or 5 years, there are going to be literally hundreds of thousands of people, mostly black people, lying in the streets of Chicago and New York City and Detroit and Miami with nowhere to go. They will be indigent. It is extremely expensive disease. At the moment, the lowest estimates are about $100,000 a year to look after somebody with full-blown AIDS. As these indigent blacks move from having HIV positive to full-blown AIDS, which can take 4 or 5 years, but we'll start doing that much earlier, there will be nowhere to put them. If you take all the hospital beds in all the jails and all the hospitals, there is no place to put the number of AIDS patients. So my guess is that it will be AIDS that breaks this thing open into public debate. Can we go to the next slide? This is a listing of all the different variables that I have studied over the last 10 years. I've talked about many of those things, like intelligence and brain size, speed of maturation. Blacks mature faster than whites. Whites mature faster than Asians. Let me just tell you, personality. Blacks are much more talkative and outgoing than are white people. White people are much more talkative and outgoing than are Asian people. So personality and temperament, you've got the differences. Let me point to something that I've got on there, twinning rates. This is a very interesting phenomenon because it calls into question real genetic explanations, or requires real good genetic explanations. The average woman ovulates once a month. In the middle of the monthly cycle, the average woman produces one egg. Occasionally that will be fertilized and you will produce one child after a 9-month gestation time. But occasionally, in fact, quite frequently, women double ovulate, triple ovulate, and quadruply ovulate. This increases the chances of one of those eggs becoming fertilized. We now know for sure that black women double and triple ovulate much more frequently than do white women. And white women double and triple ovulate much more frequently than do Asian women. The reason we know this is by looking at the number of twins or triplets that are born. The average for the white population of the United States, it is about 8 out of every 1,000 live births is a twin. 8 out of 1,000. For black people in America, it's 16 out of 1,000. For Asian women, it's less than 4 in 1,000. If you go to Africa, twinning rates actually get up to 50 out of every 1,000 live births is a twin. Now, twinning is just an indicator of the number of ovulations the woman is undergoing. What is causing these ovulations? Well, it's probably a sex hormone. But what I really want to draw your attention to, more than anything else, is that those ovulation rates, the twinning rates, show once again white people intermediate. The Asian people on the one side and African people at the other side. Now, if you've got this lineup consistently, Asians, whites, and blacks, not just on things like intelligence or crime or sexual behavior, but even on physiological variables, anatomical variables, things like twinning rates, skull size. This is not something that can be explained by any environmentalist theory that has ever been proposed. It can only be explained basically on a genetic hypothesis and ultimately on an evolutionary hypothesis. Now, the most currently accepted theory among scientists of human origins is evolution, and it is an out-of-Africa model. We now believe that humans evolved in Africa about 100,000 years ago, that we moved out of Africa, about 200,000 years ago. About 100,000 years ago, there was a exodus via the Middle East into Eurasia. And about 40,000 years ago, there was a split between Europeans and Asians. My hypothesis, my theory would suggest, along with other people, that as humankind moved out of Africa into the cold winter conditions of Europe, and especially of Siberia, which is where we think Asians evolved, that the cognitive demands, the evolutionary demands of survival in winter, especially of raising children, offspring, in the middle of a cold winter, required so much more than it ever required in Africa. You had to invent clothing. You had to invent much better shelters. You had to invent how to hunt in the winter. You had to work out how to store food. You had to have a much better trading system, much better social organization, and so on. And so the bottom line is that as Africans moved into Europe and became eventually Europeans, they did so in the direction of larger brains and lowered testosterone. And as Europeans or proto-Europeans moved into Asia, again, they did so in the direction of still larger brains and even less testosterone. This would enable not only forward planning and greater intelligence, but also de-emphasize male-male competition, sexual behavior, aggression, and allowed a much more pliant, pliable personality that could create social organizations of, as we now see in China, 1.1 billion people. Do I have any other slides left? An advertisement. Okay, we might as well put that one up. For anybody who wants to read more, it's all there in my book. There's so much more I could say, and I think I won't. What I will do is just end it on the two main points. Number one, these differences cannot be made to go away. The Asian white-black differences are deeply rooted in genetics. They're deeply rooted in evolutionary history. It would require as much time to go by with totally different breeding patterns to raise the black IQ up or to lower the Asian IQ down. So what are the predictions that I can make from this? Two. First of all, economically, any country which has large black populations are going to have trouble competing economically. Therefore, one prediction, which is certainly not novel with me, would be that the 21st century will be the Pacific century, and that Europe and Asia will fall back to being middle. And if we talk about history in the question period, I will argue that for most of human history, China has always been slightly higher than has Europe. It's the last 300 or 400 years, Europeans have pulled ahead with science and so on, but we're now slipping back to second place, which is most of human history, that is the last 10,000 years or 3,000 or 4,000 years we might have been. And the second thing is that with the prediction of AIDS, this is going to cause problems of the first magnitude, which nobody, no policymakers at all, no newspapers at all, have even begun to think about, let alone address. So thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you. It's very kind of you. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, who are the Asians and where do the Indians fit in? East Indians. No, I'm referring to Orientals, that is the Japanese, the Chinese, the Koreans. And East Indians, racially speaking, are actually Caucasian. And maybe I should make a point of this. All my research really is talking about the macro races of most white people, most Oriental people, most African people. There are all kinds of subdivisions which I really have not addressed. And these kind of finer grain analyses of, say, East Indians versus whites, or among whites, if we compare, say, Jews, who actually have the highest IQ of any ethnic group ever examined, or Gypsies, who are also arguably white, or at least Caucasian, who have IQs of about 85, which is as low as black Americans. So there's an enormous ethnic variety within the white population, as indeed there will be in the African population and in the Oriental population. So I'm talking about really huge conglomerates at the back there. Yes? There's a lot of discussion about that. Asians and Europeans are much more similar to each other, genetically speaking, than either of those two populations are to Africans. In terms of these huge studies that are now being done on mitochondrial DNA and blood testing and so on, Africans are always the furthest away from all other populations. But nonetheless, the North Asians are genetically distinct from Europeans. I'm sorry, I don't. I really don't. The repeating of, I mean, you'll always find odd studies here and there, and almost all the findings that I've given you are based on dozens of studies. I mean, these aren't just one-off studies. There are dozens and dozens. The Jewish high IQ, for example, has been found in several different European studies, as well as in the United States. So I would rank them probably the highest. Yeah. This is a question about how did Europeans discover science in the last 300 or 400 years and pull ahead of the Asians? If Asians are so smart, why didn't they discover science? Nobody really knows the answer to that question. It is a paradox. My own pet theory, although it's speculative, is that what happened was the Black Death, the plagues, the bubonic plague that swept Europe in the 1300s and 1400s, really killed off maybe two-thirds of the population. And just like all these plagues, they always differentially affect the lower half or lower two-thirds of the population, leaving the aristocracy, relatively speaking, unscathed. So what you did was suddenly have this very high IQ European population left that then suddenly began moving into cities and created the Renaissance. And that led to science. And so it was a freak accident, essentially, which is now beginning to right itself. That's my own personal judgment. I should say that in 1442, 50 years before Columbus discovered America, and when he discovered America, by the way, he had three ships and about 100 people. In 50 years before that, the Chinese, with something like 200 ships and 20,000 people, landed on the east coast of Africa. They had the magnetic compass. They could, if they had chosen, gone around the Cape of Good Hope and discovered Europe and colonized Europe in the same way that Europeans colonized the Americas. They chose not to. They loaded up their boats with the giraffe and hippopotamuses, perhaps black Africans as well. They took them back to China for the edification of the Chinese emperor, and for a variety of reasons, the prevailing classes then decided they did not want the merchant class to, in fact, expand. They burned the boats, they burned the plans, they built up the Great Wall, and they began to go back to being inward-looking as they had been for the previous 1,400 years. But that's an incredible contrast. I mean, you think, even today, 20,000 people, it said, the University of Western Ontario, the entire student body, the logistics of moving 20,000 students from Western to, say, Vancouver, just for a field trip for a week, would be mind-boggling. And for the Chinese to have done what they did in 1442 is consistent with the argument that they were an incredibly well-socially organized and intelligent, scientifically intelligent race back then. And so it's a mystery how white Europeans pulled ahead in the last 300 or 400 years. Yes. The question is about brain size and convolutions in the brain. The 13 studies using magnetic resonance imaging have only looked at total brain size. The question now is, where in the brain is intelligence, and what is it about the brain? If the whole brain correlates around 0.44, can you increase that correlation to 0.6 or 0.7 by taking better measures of the brain? And the answer is yes. People right now are looking at convolutions. The idea would be, this is how much wrinkling there is in the brain. The argument would be that it's the total surface area of the brain that is important. And if you take the convolutions into account, then we think you will find that whites have much larger brains even than they already do. But even the quarter pound of gray matter that I've been speaking about translates into hundreds of millions of neurons and synapses. It's plenty to explain the IQ difference. The question is about how many neurons there are in the brain, and does that predict IQ? The probability is yes. But people haven't really done these studies yet. We're looking at new kinds of magnetic resonance imaging that can give you very, very fine detail, but those studies are just not in yet. The question is, what is the reception of these ideas in Asia? I'm very happy to report that my book is just about to come out in Japan in a Japanese translation, and there is some interest in the possibility of a Chinese translation. Actually, there's some interest also in a Spanish translation. There is not that much interest in Japan and China, or even among the Asians in America, in race differences. They are frankly embarrassed by it. They, first of all, do not want to be held up to any kind of attention at all, really. But they certainly do not want to be held up as in any way at all superior to white people, because they are deathly afraid that the immigration lobby will slam down the gates on the ground, as they did, by the way, back in the early part of the century, not on the grounds that the Asians were dangerous people to have in because they were crime-prone, but rather that the Asians worked so hard, they were unfairly competitive to the white person. And it was trade unions, basically, that lobbied to get rid of Chinese immigration. And the Chinese are afraid of that now. Even today, there is increasing resentment in our campuses, anyway, among white students about Asian students. And Asians are very sensitive to that. For example, somebody trying to get into medical school who needs doing pre-meds in, say, chemistry, will walk into a lab, he needs to get a 90% mark in order to get into medical school, he'll see that 50% of the class is Asian, and he says, oh my goodness, there goes the bell curve. It's going to be much harder for him to get an A grade in that class, and therefore get into medical school, than if the class was made up of, say, Hispanics or blacks. So Asians do not like these theories for self-protective reasons. Yes. I don't look at Hispanics, and Hispanics is basically a language base. You could be a Japanese Hispanic. You could be a black Hispanic. You could be a white Hispanic. I believe that most of the Mexicans that are coming in are probably hybrids of part white and part a native person, American Indian. But I haven't really looked at them. Their IQs are higher than blacks, but not as high as whites. Yes. Yes, the answer is yes, it is true. The question is about the distribution of intelligence in the different populations. It looks as though Asians, even though they have a slightly higher IQ than whites, it's a much narrower band. So they don't have the same percentage of geniuses, they don't have the same percentage of retarded people. White distribution is much more spread out, there's much more variation. That seems to be true. So whites may have more real geniuses than do Asians. That's a very real possibility. Yes. I don't usually answer personal questions. They fall into the what do you have for breakfast category. But breast milk is, as far as IQ is concerned, breast milk, the studies are now coming out showing that breast milk is better for IQ development, probably because it has some fatty acids in it, which is very good for brain development, and that all the modern formula don't have that. As far as my two doctorates, really, I got a PhD in psychology, and I'm a psychologist at the University of London, which is where I graduated in England. After you've had your PhD for about 10 years, if you wish to, you can apply for a Doctor of Science degree, which is a higher doctorate, and you just send them basically all your articles, and then they award you a higher degree if you pay them £400 or £500 or something. So that's my higher doctorate. Yes, the question is why does breastfeeding work? Is it a confound that just more intelligent women breastfeed? There has been another study, I can't recall exactly where it was, I think it was the New England Journal of Medicine. It was over the last few months because it made the newspapers relatively recently. And what they did, they matched women for IQ, and they showed that even then breast milk was advantageous. But I'm not a real expert in that. Yes, Richard Lynn's study on Africans showed that black Africans have an IQ of about 70, which is 15 points lower than black Americans. One obvious possible explanation is that black Americans are in fact 25% white, and it is that 25% white which has increased the black American IQ. The other evidence to show that hybrids and genetic admixture raises black IQ is to look at intelligence. Lighter-skinned black people have higher IQs than do darker-skinned black people. And there are even studies, like the transracial adoption study, a very famous study in Minnesota, which showed that children who were adopted into white upper-middle-class homes what does that do for their IQ? And the answer is, when they're, by the time they're age 17, not very much. But the children who were adopted who had two black biological parents had much lower IQ scores than did the children who were adopted who had one black parent and one white parent. And they were intermediate to the children who were adopted who had two white parents. So this is the kind of technical evidence that people use to show that the black-white difference in IQ is genetic. The black population explosion, the African population explosion, has been to date muted, cut back a little bit by AIDS. But, I mean, it would have been so much greater if it wasn't for AIDS than it already is. But despite AIDS, it has been exploding, no question about it. These latest figures on HIV infection rates, 20% of the population and so on, are so recent that nobody has matched that up to the birth rates and made any kind of demographic predictions about whether African population will actually decline. Certainly, the economies will collapse. It may leave millions of children between the ages of 6 and 15 who are not yet sexually active, who will then grow to sexual maturity. Bottom line is, so far, AIDS and HIV infection rate has not impacted the population explosion of Africa, but the prediction will be that sooner or later it will do. As far as the nature of the Asian white IQ difference, there's no question that the difference is greatest on what we call spatial intelligence. That's where the Asians have a distinct, definite advantage. It may or may not be the case that Caucasians are higher than Asians on verbal IQ. But what we call general intelligence, which is an amalgam of a number of these specific abilities, they are fractionally higher. That's a very technical question about how much variation there is in the three different races and how do you explain the different variances. I don't know. I'll have to pass on that. I mean, your prediction's as good as mine as to what the general impact of these ideas in the world is, and what's going to happen in the future as far as the acceptance of these ideas. We're always continually disappointed when we publish yet another article showing completely clearly that these are genetic differences, and this must make the New York Times science page on Tuesday, and somehow Harvard is going to come along and double my salary and offer me a full professorship there, and it just doesn't happen. And well, maybe next year it will happen, but I can't really make a prediction. Yes. Let me respond to that. It's a very, very good question, and that is, I too began to study AIDS in the mid-1980s. In the middle 1980s, there was no question that these projections that are now coming to pass were made. But what you might be forgetting is that at the same time, all the scientists who were publishing the original AIDS figures were saying this is going to take 10 or 15 years. And they also warned that because it would take 10 or 15 years, AIDS as an issue would be widely covered in the first 2 or 3 years because it was so new. And then it was going to die down a lot in public attention because it was not all the big doom and gloom consequences had not come to pass, but that they would do, it said, by the turn of the century. And so I think if you read what they were, the cautions they were saying that we shouldn't lose interest in AIDS, and the 10 or 15 year projections, I think that is what is coming. As far as the changing definition of what is AIDS, or what constitutes AIDS, that is true. The classification of that disease alters. The more knowledge we get, sometimes we expand it, sometimes we contract it. And when we expand the criterion, we obviously begin to include more people than we had before. And some people like to say, well, you see, this is all manufactured. But let me remind you, the data I just gave you was not about AIDS. It's something much, much more profound. It was about HIV. Which is the virus that causes the disease. Now, I know a lot of people, some people don't believe that it's a virus, but 98% of scientists believe it is, I believe it is, all the evidence shows that it is, and if it is a virus, that virus is detectable by tests, it's in the bloodstreams, they do random surveys of people in the armed forces, people who go into hospitals, random sampling of prostitutes and truck drivers and so on. They put all these figures together and they make their projections. And these HIV rates are absolutely colossal. No, I'm not predicting that at all. In fact, if anything, I'm saying it's not. It's a major threat to black people, and it is to black people, homosexuals, and drug and intravenous drug users. That's correct. Carlton Kuhn was a wonderful, great physical anthropologist who was writing in the late 50s and early 60s. In fact, actually, he published his last book in 1982. And he put forward then the first really scientific theory about the origins of the races. I won't go into the details of it, except to say that it had some fundamental differences from the one I've just described. His theory is still going. There are physical anthropologists who believe it. A man called Milford Wolpoff at the University of Michigan is the main proponent of it today, and it is an alternative. I would say that it's been hugely debated over the last 10 years whether the out-of-Africa model that I presented to you is the correct one, or whether a Carlton Kuhn-type multi-regional theory was a better one. Today, probably 80% of physical anthropologists buy the out-of-Africa model, about 20%, maybe 30% buy the Carlton Kuhn-type model, although much modified. In my book, I review both, and strictly speaking, trying to explain racial differences, it doesn't really matter which of those two theories or some other amalgam of them turns out to be more correct. But my own reading is very much that Carlton Kuhn had some of the details wrong, and I mean, 30 years later, we should be in a better position with an even more precise theory than we were 30 years ago. So I guess I do slightly disagree with you. Well, there's been a lot of discussion about whether world wars are dysgenic in the sense of creaming off the high IQ population and therefore making the country lower in IQ. As far as modern day studies are concerned, we cannot detect, at least with relatively insensitive tests, that Germany today or Great Britain today or France today has a markedly lower IQ than it would have had if the First World War or the Second World War had not happened. In fact, paradoxically, the data, if you can believe it, I think Mike Levin mentioned it this morning, IQs seem to be rising in all the different countries of the world. There is no evidence that Germany, let's say, or Britain had a certain level of IQ and then it dropped. And then it went back up, and then it dropped again as a function of different consequences. We have no fine-grained analysis. There's no evidence for that in that theory. It's a very interesting hypothesis, and in principle is testable. I mean, we should be able to go back and look at old populations and estimate their IQs from brain sizes and so on. The trouble is, as we all know, this is such a taboo topic and has been such a taboo topic for 60 years that fascinating questions, I mean, absolutely fascinating questions of this kind cannot be researched. Now, my belief is that the physical anthropologists who do blood types and mitochondrial DNA and DNA analyses and so on are mapping all the different populations of the world. Most of them try to put a politically correct spin on what they do in order to keep getting the funds, in order to keep doing the research. But the data that they're presenting, which shows how genetically related the different populations are to each other, that's the wave of the future. Very soon, we will be able to extract DNA from skeletons, say the Egyptian mummies, for example, and then analyze that DNA from the Egyptian mummies and see which of the modern populations were those Egyptian mummies closest to today, or in the ancient Greeks, or the ancient Israelites? We should, in principle, be able to, or Neanderthal, find DNA and match them up to modern populations. Yes? As far as we know, the modern Western Europeans, Cro-Magnons. Only in the most crazily speculative manner. In principle, you could say, well, look, in fact, they're looking for the IQ gene right now. They're looking for the crime gene right now. Some teams think they found it, but it might be 3 or 4 more years before it gets published. Once we find genes that really make a significant difference on crime or IQ, in principle, we should be able to find an enzyme or a drug that will counterbalance any harmful effect. So you should be able to improve people's IQ. But this is in the world of science fiction, and maybe I shouldn't speculate any further than that. Yeah. The question is, are there other people coming online? And the answer is basically no. You've looked at the consequences of Sam Francis being fired from the Washington Times. I mean, that is not an inspirational story for a young 21-year-old journalist to say, well, I don't give a damn. I'm going to pursue this topic anyway. And you get that in the universities if somebody wants to do a PhD. I know people today who've collected brain-sized data using magnetic resonance imaging on Asians, whites, and blacks. They will not publish it. One person is publishing it, and he says, I promise when I get tenure, I will publish it. They say, quite reasonably to me, I think, you go out and make this topic respectable, and I'll publish. But today, if they publish, at that point in time, that is immediately the end of their grants. They will have no more research money to do the research. So why would anybody publish? You'll get a few people like Mike Levin and Richard Lynn and me and Charles Murray who are willing to, we've got a secure position or whatever it is that makes us do it, but you cannot expect until this topic becomes really respectable for all kinds of people to say, I don't give a damn. In Japan, the average IQ tests show anywhere from 104 to 111. The People's Republic of China have just standardized an IQ test. It ended up as an IQ of 101. So there is a range of anywhere from 1 IQ point advantage over whites to an 11 IQ point advantage over whites. Most scientists who are willing to address that topic, like Charles Murray, for example, when they review the literature, come up with something like about a 5-point advantage overall for Asians in Asia and perhaps for Asians in America. Yes. I'm not sure which scientific findings. Well, as near as I've been able to tell, and if I write another book on the history of all of this, the German National Socialist era and the 20s and 30s is something that I would want to look at. I understand that the Nazis were taking all kinds of skull size measurements, in the sense that they were very interested in the length of the head and the width of the head. And from that, they would calculate some kind of index of head shape. They were very interested in knowing whether the shape of the German head was different from, say, the shape of the Jewish head or the Slavic East European head. And indeed, it seemed to be that it was, that the Germans and the North Europeans have a relatively speaking longish, narrow head, and the Jews and East Europeans have a relatively wider head. But they never did what I would have thought would be the obvious, and which I would like to do with their data, or maybe they did and they didn't like what they found. What you should do is multiply the length of the head times the width of the head, and therefore get a measure of the volume of the brain inside the head. This, as far as I know, they never did, but I would be very curious if they did do that. I would have expected, although I don't know, but I would have expected they might have found that, first of all, East Europeans, and especially East Asians, if you go far enough to the Orient, should have larger skulls than do even the Germans. And as far as the IQ test is concerned, I've seen four or five references, not very specific, to the effect that Hitler banned IQ tests from the German schools around 1937, on the grounds that IQ tests were Jewish. In the same way that Stalin banned IQ tests around the 1930s because they were bourgeois. And it would not be altogether surprising to me if that had occurred, because I would have expected that the Jews in the German schools would have ended up with a higher IQ than the Germans in the German schools. Hitler and the Nazis paid a lot of attention to the fact that Berlin and German culture and German universities, as Hungarian universities and Eastern European universities generally, were overrepresented with Jewish professors, the medical schools, the legal professions, the theaters, the culture. And this would be compatible with the view that, in fact, Jews in Germany at that time had a higher IQ, were rising to positions of influence, which I presume Germans, like German National Socialists, would have found very offensive. But as far as the actual data on IQ tests and brain size that I'm finding, I have no idea what the Nazis found. And I cannot imagine if they did find anything, that if I was a National Socialist scientist and I had come up with the kind of findings that I have come up with, I think that the war stories that I could tell you about today would pale into insignificance. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Yeah. Yeah, there's some truth in that. The Africans have gone through an incredible metamorphosis. During the early 1980s or mid-1980s, they first of all denied that they had any AIDS at all, because they did not want the perception to be that Africans were promiscuous, and that this was a stereotype they did not want the Europeans to pursue. So at first, they minimized their AIDS figures. Today, when sometimes the World Health Organization is the only real organization in town, they are inflating or trying to inflate their figures in order to attract dollars. That's why the World Health Organization is extremely careful, as or tries to be as careful as it can, to rule out a variety of different kinds of biases. And what I do in my data is, I have an entire chapter in my book about methodology, and I use this argument that we must aggregate. If you don't trust the data in Uganda or South Africa or Nigeria about crime, about IQ, about AIDS, or about anything, but if you take an average of many, many, many different countries over many, many different years, and they are consistently in the same direction, then at least you can be sure of the direction of the data, even if the absolute raw numbers are not spot on, or in fact, way off. Yes. It's certainly theoretically possible, and if I had to put my money on how to raise your IQ in any way, shape, or form, or your children's IQ better still, I would put my money on vitamins and minerals of some kind like that. But I really don't know that there's any good evidence for it. In principle, there is. There are no racial differences in identical twinning. It's fraternal twinning as a result of a double ovulation. Triplets and quadruplets just show the same racial pattern as do dizygotic twinning. It's just multiple birthing. Multiple birthing is much more frequent in black than it is in white, much more frequent in white. The second question was about the Chris Brand affair, and I'll tell you just very briefly about that. Christopher Brand is a professor of psychology at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland. He published a book about 3 or 4 months ago called The G Factor. It's all about intelligence. It is a watered-down version, is a gentle version of the bell curve, much milder than the bell curve. It was published by Wiley, John Wiley and Sons, UK Wiley. And the book was published 3 months ago. It had sales of about 500 copies. And then there was a press conference organized by Wiley in order to help support Chris Brand's sale of the book. And at the press conference or the press interview, Brand was asked about the black-white differences. And he said, sure, there's a black-white difference between IQ points. And sure, it's genetic, or most people believe it's genetic, and I believe it's genetic instead. The newspaper then said, well, doesn't that make you a scientific racist? And Christopher Brand said, well, if you want to define scientific racism as somebody who believes in black-white differences being genetic, I suppose it does. Yes, it does. So the next day, there were headlines. I'm proud to be a scientific racist. And as they say, all hell broke loose. In fact, the most curious thing about it in the very first week, to me anyway, is that the Scottish nationalists who are trying to break Scotland away from Britain, separate and have their own government, actually the Scottish nationalist members of parliament in Britain were the first to denounce Brand as a racist and call for him to be dismissed from the university. I've never quite got that straight as to why that could be, but anyway, the point is that all kinds of people began to demand that Brand resign, that he be fired, and of course the normal cast of villains, the media and so on, got involved, and this has been going on for 6 weeks. The peculiar thing about it is that Wiley, New York, decided to cancel the book, and they overruled Wiley, UK, and the book was recalled, it was withdrawn from circulation. This is a scandal of first proportion. As far as we know, there's never been a scientific academic book pulled by its publisher after it was already published for a long period of time. This is now an ongoing debate. People are writing letters on Chris Brand's behalf. There are a couple of other publishers, including Transaction, my own publisher, who are interested in taking up the flag and getting the G factor from Wiley. But it does show the terrible problems of trying to publish in this area. You can do it, but it's just an uphill battle all the time. The question is, what about women's brains? Women have smaller brains than men, and yet they do not have lower IQs. Well, this is a real scientific paradox. It is absolutely amazing. Let me put the paradox in its worst form, or most startling form. Black men have a larger brain than do white women, even when you correct for body size. But black men have a much lower IQ than do white women. So for a scientist like me trying to say, look, there's a relationship between brain size and IQ, how do you explain this paradox? Well, paradox was really first noted only in 1992. In fact, when I and Professor David Ankeny at my university began to publish these brain size analyses of the United States Army. Incredible though it may seem, it had not been known since about 1860 when Paul Broca back in France first began to publish autopsy data. But it's a very interesting wrinkle on this whole issue. The solution that we think we've put forward, there's been about three different solutions put forward to explain this scientific paradox, but the one that I think we favor, that men, in addition, brain size mediates two kinds of intelligence. The first is general intelligence, which shows up on the MRI and so on. But the second kind of intelligence, on which men and women basically don't differ. But the second kind of intelligence, which men and women differ on enormously, much bigger even than do white and black, and it is what we call dynamic spatial ability. It translates into catching balls, throwing balls, targeting anything, throwing darts, any kind of orientation in space, women, in fact, are very, very poor at. So are very young girls. There are studies being done by Doreen Kimura in my university where they take a very low velocity table tennis ball, and the child sits on a chair, and all she or he has to do is to reach out a hand and knock down the ball as it goes past. Women make, little girls make far more errors at this than do little boys. If you take an Olympic sport like target shooting, if you are aiming a rifle at a stationary target, there are almost no differences between men and women. In fact, if anything, women have a slightly superior advantage in target shooting at a stationary target. But as soon as you introduce movement, so a moving target where you have to orient towards a three-dimensional space, women do not make the Olympic team. They do not make anything close to getting on the Olympic team. So it looks like there is a real male-female difference in what we call dynamic spatial ability. Maybe in spatial ability and mathematical ability as well, that's more controversial. But we think that is what most of the human brain is probably going to process, is, in fact, keeping the body balanced. And it would make perfect sense from an evolutionary perspective why men who are roaming around from the home base, hunting in packs, basically, why they would need to be able to orient in three-dimensional space, find their way back to the home after the hunt, maybe going 4 or 5 days away from camp. Women stayed stationary to look after the children. This would create that kind of extra brain tissue. If you think of a computer, and you want to increase your processing capacity, verbal processing, word processing capacity, you need more memory. But as soon as you add a graphics package, which is three dimensions, you really have to jump enormously in processing capacity. So what we think, men have bigger brains than women because men are better at dynamic spatial ability. And we think that is probably the resolution of that paradox. The question is about the Human Genome Project and getting right down into the molecular genetics. There is no question that the Human Genome Project, from our point of view, is just one of the most wonderful things that is going on. It's mapping the entire human genome all around the world. There are people at the University of London in England right now who are looking for the IQ gene. They think informally they may even have found it. What they do is they look for brothers in the same class where one brother has an IQ of about 80 and the other brother has, in the same school, the other brother has an IQ of about 130. So if you go through the entire London school districts, you will find a few sibling pairs, brothers, who are that 50 IQ points different. It's very unusual to get that degree of a range within the same family. Now, if you limit yourself to saying upper middle class children with that degree of discrepancy, you're suddenly saying, what is it about this one child that's giving him an IQ of 80, where his brother has an IQ of 130, and his parents have IQs of 130, and he's come from an upper middle class background. So then you take blood samples, and you start going through the entire genome looking for where the brothers have mismatches. And you're doing this over many, many different kinds of brothers. When you find a mismatch, you can find whether all the low IQ brothers have the same mismatch or a similar mismatch. If you do find that, you may have found an IQ gene. And we now think that single genes which have many, many different loci could underlie almost all the variation of IQ. As soon as that's found, and drug companies, by the way, are just pouring millions into this, because the promise is, it may not be fulfilled, but the promise is that when you can find mild retardation, we can cure it. In the same way that when we can find schizophrenia, we can cure that. Or Alzheimer's, we can cure it. We can certainly do a lot to alleviate it, even if we can't cure it. So this study is right now ongoing. It's just a matter of time, maybe say 4 years, conservatively. And once we find the IQ gene or a IQ gene, then we just go through currently existing blood samples to find out whether blacks have this low IQ gene more than do whites. Once that is found, the scientific question will be largely settled. Yeah, and the question is about spatial IQ between blacks and whites and athletic ability. There's no question that blacks have physical advantages over whites in some sports, they have more testosterone, they have more muscle mass, they have a different shaped body. They're much better at a fast spurt, accelerations or jumping and so on. Now, as far as the, I beg your pardon? I wouldn't buy the theoretical origin of it, but yes, basically. As far as spatial IQ is concerned, Asians have higher spatial IQ than whites. Whites have higher spatial IQ than blacks. Any more questions? I think it's a very good question. I think some of the things that Jared Taylor was talking about in his talk that seem to be unique to Western man have not been really studied. I mean, these finer grain analyses of subgroup differences, whether they're German versus other European, North European versus South European, whatever kinds of differences, the more subtle kinds of personality or social organizational variables, just have not been studied, and they should be studied. They're fascinating questions, and we're going to learn an awful lot more when we do break this taboo. My work is really confined to relatively broad-based, simple questions like IQ scores in one country or another, rather than abstract reasoning ability. I don't know. What to do is the perennial question. I think we all probably ask ourselves that. How can we be more effective? To some extent, I believe that there is a division of labor, and it's a reasonable division of labor. That is, I am an academic. It's probably best for me to fight academic battles by organizing academics into organizations. And in fact, in Canada, we now have a Society for Academic Freedom and Scholarship, which has about 400 university professors, that originated primarily because of my case and some other cases of political correctness. In the United States, you have the National Association of Scholars, which has about, three, maybe even close to 4,000 professors now. Of course, they're nowhere near as strong as they ought to be or as we would like them to be, but they are organized against political correctness. I guess I feel that each of us should really find our own niche in the best way to be effective, and then pursue that for the degree to which you feel comfortable with. So I'm not sure that Jared Taylor had a very good idea, which was that people should leave money in their wills.